early game. He was setting up Maple as well in that Katarina. So if he goes off this game, he could maybe carry this game.
And you mentioned two champions. We feel like NALCS have to target the Lee Sin and the Katarina, or at least have to be a thought in the draft.
They do, but, you know, do they have to ban the Katarina? I don't know, because Bjergsen can play Katarina, right? This is a guy who plays Assassins, and when I found out I'm casting this matchup, that's exactly what I'm thinking. Maple and Bjergsen both are Assassin players. We've been seeing them get so many bans, but, well, okay, there it goes.
Interestingly, though, this comes out
my dreams are dead.
LMS. It's the LMS that are targeting this, perhaps looking at a different mid laner here, because if we do see this, the likes of a LeBlanc and a Ryze are still available here. I would anticipate them to be the last two bans out, but that's a lot of mid lane focus.
Yeah, it certainly is. And, I mean, Bjergsen got triple banned yesterday. It's kind of the Bjergsen special. He gets a lot of focus, both in champ select and in game. But they're going to take Twitch off the table because of how well Doublelift did. And it's just a really strong champion. But, I mean, yesterday, Doublelift was, what, 14-1 or something?
Disgusting.
Yeah.
Also in the 1v1s as well. So not everyone seems to know exactly how
1v1,
new Twitch works.
1v1, not so hot, though.
Yeah, but people are, like, standing in the poison. People don't understand how it's working now in the new patch.
And now NA get forced into a tough spot. It's either Ryze or LeBlanc, because Cassiopeia's taken off the table.
The thing is, you don't have to ban either. If you're okay playing both sides of the matchup, you can ban something else. Leave two OPs open, say, okay, sure, you first pick Ryze, I take LeBlanc. You first pick LeBlanc, I take Ryze. And now it's kind of crunch time. How confident is Bjergsen playing both sides of the matchup? Because if you ban away one, likely the other goes over to Maple, but you can leave two OPs open and just trade.
And that's exactly what they're going to do
with the Zyra as the final ban here, man. I can't wait to see a LeBlanc. And I mean, there's pretty much 100% chance we're going to see it now.
Oh, baby, there it is. The insta lock for Maple on that LeBlanc.
Oh, this is thrown. The first LoL Esports game that LeBlanc has been available in the picks, and it's instantly first pick, not through IWCA. Nor All-Star from yesterday was it available at this point. So we finally get to see what it can do in a traditional Summoner's Rift matchup. Everybody's been talking about just how strong it is.
And it's being piloted by one of the best mid laners in the world. Maple is incredible. This guy has been dominant for so long, and I'm very excited to see what he can do with it, because this champion is so flexible. When you're playing against someone who is a master of the new LeBlanc, honestly, it's hard to tell what's even going on at times.
Yeah, he can juke even the casters. I've seen that clone just go all over the place. But Maple now the pioneer of these new picks.
And as we turn our attention after one strong pick, we look over on the other side, North America. They're going to take one pick they played yesterday in a very strong top laner when you look at the Poppy. That's a champion that's seen multiple bans come through as well.
Yeah. And The clock is obviously kind of having a bit of a malfunction here in champ select, but we will continue on as normal. You can just ignore that for now. But, you know, the Poppy, and we're going to have Rain Over back on Rengar. That's pretty exciting. We saw him go tank yesterday. I'm kind of hoping he goes for the full damage build that we did see played later in the day.
Yeah, I love seeing that Assassin potential. And, you know, out of the jungle matchup, when you look at that, if you go full damage, you got to wonder, what is LMS going to pick? Ziv, will he go for the Nautilus up in the top lane to go against the Poppy? It's pretty much the matchup everybody is playing. Those two plus Maokai makes up the trifecta of top.
Courage of the Colossus boys has made a lot of strong top laners relevant again. Waiting on the LMS to lock in their picks. They have around 10 seconds, not 0 seconds, so don't panic. And it will be the Jhin and Nautilus picked up. So you were just mentioning the Nautilus in the top lane, but also Jhin going down there for BB.
And I think it makes a lot of sense. Nautilus was already a champion that was honestly pretty good. We had seen it have a lot of success in pro play last year. It took a couple nerfs, it fell out, but it was always kind of right on the cusp. And Courage of the Colossus is what has kind of put it over the edge here. Definitely does match up okay against the Poppy. I do think that Poppy kind of has the advantage in these matchups, though, both against the Nautilus and the Maokai, if only so slightly.
We also yesterday saw the pivot to put Nautilus down in the bottom side, which was, you know, perhaps not in everybody's mind the strongest of supports, but with Redemption, with Courage of the Colossus, it actually makes up for a lot of the shortcomings. So maybe to play it in a protective capacity alongside the Jhin, because you've got a Rengar that's going to be coming for your AD carry in every single team fight.
And while it's probably too slow of a clear for pro play, Nautilus jungle is actually solid in solo queue in that kind of situation as well. So this is a champion that can be played all across the map. We even have seen at times Nautilus mid, you know, doing like banner rush and some silly things like that, but I definitely don't think we'll see that today. I'm expecting it to be top, could be flex support.
Yeah. We did see a Nautilus mid lane. I could talk about that, but I don't think it's going to happen for quite some time. Ryze will be picked up, though, as we were talking about at the start of Champion Select. You pick the LeBlanc, and of course, in return, we'll see Ryze on the other side. And then Karma will come down, most likely at the support now, as we have Ryze locked in.
And the Ryze pick, it's one of the picks everybody said will do well into LeBlanc, but you still always have the same problem. The early part of the game against a LeBlanc, you've got to contain the snowball. Ryze can roam with his ultimate decently well, and when you hit 11, it's actually okay, and you can kind of follow in time.
And it's also something where if I'm playing against the LeBlanc, you're not just worrying about the LeBlanc, you're worrying about the jungler as well, especially because Rengar is not as strong in the early ganks as a Graves, right? He's someone who wants to kind of power farm to six, and Bjergsen is going to have to deal with jungle focus. If you get chained and the Graves arrives, it can be all over.
And here's this lock-in from LMS to finish out their lineup. It's going to be Sona coming in there for the support here.
And just look now at some of the crowd control aspects that the Sona and the Nautilus will have. Whether it's the Sona peeling for Jhin as a Rengar tries to come in, or looking for the teamfight setup from the Flash Crescendo, we don't see Sona very often, typically because of her laning squishiness and kind of the difficulty that you can have with that. But there's always the sustain game. There's always that ability.
Yeah, and I find myself wishing that Aphromoo had saved his pick for last. He could be locking in the Blitzcrank right now. But unfortunately, we're not going to get to see it. They have saved that last pick for the AD carry and Doublelift. If you're locking in the Caitlyn last, you're being tryhard, and that's what it's going to be.
Yeah, it is. It's going to be locked in for Doublelift. Doublelift wants to win this one. He's seen Albiz pick up the Sona here, so we have the full lineups now, gentlemen. What are you thinking?
It basically meant that he couldn't lock in any kind of Vayne or anything with the Karma as well. So Doublelift and Aphromoo are going for the pushing game with the Karma, with the Caitlyn. We saw this all the way through Worlds. So I quite like what NALCS have brought to the table here. The Rengar is going to be critical to allow them to get the Ryze and the Caitlyn into their power later on in the game. But certainly, the LMS have a scary, scary amount of burst at the same time.
Yeah, they definitely do. I think their team is much more about picks. I think that the LeBlanc, the Jhin, aren't going to be as strong and straight up kind of 5v5 smashing against each other as that Ryze and the Caitlyn are. These guys are kind of more straightforward, more strong in the team fight. But there's so much potential to roam around and to catch people out. You have massive engage with the Nautilus, with this LeBlanc to be able to follow up, and the Jhin as well. So there's a lot of catch tools here, and I could see them moving around the map and kind of catching people out.
Yeah, and in terms of how the LMS were playing yesterday and in terms of how they were getting those advantages, I feel like this is almost the perfect lineup for them. You have LeBlanc and Graves, and you just walk into the mid lane. Have fun, Bjergsen. I'm just going to insta-pop you from 100 to 0.
Exactly. As soon as someone gets that chains on them, they've got a flash or they're getting taken out by Kassa and Maple.
And Maple is going to go right back to the TP. He played TP Katarina yesterday. We saw him actually be pretty effective on that. Some TPs to the top lane where they were able to take out multiple kills, you know, once the bot lane duo had rotated up there. And he's someone who is going to be looking to kind of obviously get through lane right here. He's not taking Ignite. He's not someone who's going to have to kill Bjergsen, especially with this summoner.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're heading on to Rift, but before we do so, vote at LOL Esports doing the hashtags, hashtag IceWin or hashtag FireWin as we get into our first game of the day. It will be LMS versus NA taking it to the Rift.
As we get onto the Rift, we can see for Graves, for Kassa, starting out with one of the control wards, going to try and prioritize a little bit of vision. Of course, Graves, his clear is pretty good. You knock back the camps, you can kind of stay sustained through the early game. So we'll see how that vision actually impacts the early game for Reyno, because that's where he struggled a little yesterday against Jankos.
And if you can get those early control wards down, if you don't get spotted in the early game, you can sometimes have these wards that sit around for so, so long. But look at this, fire sneaking around here behind Bebe.
Oh man, I feel like someone's gonna die. Someone's have to burn some summoners in the second half. Right over, turn the corner. Albiz is gonna see him. He's taking the brunt of the damage. He'll have to flash away as BB returns fire.
Oh, that makes this a very difficult laning phase now for Albiz. He's gonna kind of have to sit back. You cannot now play forward on the Sona where you're looking.
Interrupt.
Oh.
Yeah, that's actually really important there for Doublelift. They delay the base even further. Aphro may be able to do so again.
Oh, again.
And Albiz now, he can't really base. If he does, he's leaving his AD carry out to dry. So this is just a brutal position for Albiz and BB.
Aphro, he's going all the way around to try and find the next interrupt, but doesn't find it, unfortunately. But still, massive hit there. BB's going to have to stay in there. And he's just trying to do something.
So he's going to be in lane for himself, on his own at the moment. You can see Caitlyn and Karma are actually just sitting there trying to shove the wave already. Just trying to get in position to make sure that they can take that early push.
All right, taking a look at Keystones as well, you can see the double Colossus. And finally, we do have the rise of Courage of the Colossus as well, something we weren't seeing in IWCA.
But we'd heard a lot about Kira from the CIS region, apparently in scrims and in solo queue had been playing a whole bunch of it because of just how sticky Ryze is. You get, you know, the Rune Prison, you get everything, and you get such a big shield that he outputs so much damage despite, you know, lacking a damage Keystone Master.
And I mean, it's not really even just the stickiness, it's about he turns into a semi-tank. You're already going to be building the Seraph's Embrace. You have the shield from that. You have the Courage of Colossus shield. You have the shield from his passive. Then you're building a Rod of Ages, which is also more tanky. So he becomes just ridiculously hard to kill.
Yeah, Yo Dog, I heard you like shields, so I've got a shield with my shield on my shield. And Bjergsen will be doing massive damage regardless. I remember, like, when we were seeing Ryze last week, he was hitting people like 1.6k with Q combo.
He was, but he's got to be careful in these early game trades because Mako, once he gets this stack up, you can see even the additional kind of bounces from the AoE that LeBlanc now has. He's doing so much damage.
He's walking down Bjergsen, but that massive shield's going to keep him alive. Bjergsen out of mana here. Maple's going to make it back to his tower.
Yeah, and Maple is trading into this big wave with the cannon minion shooting him, and that is massive in the early game. You can't actually just ignore the minion damage. Bjergsen was taking a lot of poke from Maple, but he had such a heavy wave advantage that it was evened out by those minions.
Very close there. Kasa just clearing up his jungle here. Haven't seen too much interactions between the junglers, but he did go for the pot stock, so very healthy, whereas Rainover went for the refillable potion. And after we're going to head back into the bottom lane here with double lift, you can see a very big CS advantage being built up after that level one play that they made. And BB trying to get all the CS he can, but constantly being zoned back. This is an oppressive lane from Team Fire.
And this is the kind of lane now where Albus has to be incredibly careful stepping forward to try and do any damage. A lot of people will look at the Sona poke and say, okay, well, surely you can utilize that. But look, Albus is now caught by a trap. He has to take a very dangerous path out and a trade back on top of him. Apple does get caught, though.
Yeah, going to run him down just a little as Albus puts some damage back on towards double lift. And he'll put the pressure down here in the bottom lane. So going to be evening it out for a little bit. Lane we haven't spoken about just yet is top lane, probably for good reason, but see the junglers kind of butt heads. And Rainer's going to shimmy back to his jungle. I love the new Q where you just kind of look forward a little bit.
Yeah, top lane, the CS is pretty even. Nothing too crazy is going to happen unless there are roams up there, unless there are those ganks.
Speaking of roams.
Pearson taking a little walk up the river.
He's having a stroll. He's fine. And the scrying plant will spot him on his way back to the mid lane as well. Very strong plant indeed. Lots of vision coming out from that one. And Impact has his massive wave on the tower, so he's going to resolve this one and be pretty good with Ziv in the top lane. So back into the bottom lane where we actually have some trading going on. And Maple still in this mid lane against Bjergsen, so survived the all-in trade earlier.
Again, though, this heavy CS advantage for Doublelift and Aphromoo, they've always got this push constantly up towards the tower, which gives so much freedom to Rainover on the bottom side of the map that he can start looking to, you know, place vision control, maybe end up clearing out this control ward that's in the river further up, as long as Bjergsen can cover for him and allow him just to get into that area.
Yeah, and let's be honest, so much of it was about the level one. They essentially got cheesed
out.
Oh,
yeah.
The flashes forced, they delayed the base so long that, you know, Albus, not only is he at a disadvantage to start the lane, he's there late, but he then has to play safer until Flash is up, which it is now. So you can hope that this is going to stabilize a little bit for them as they can play a little bit more aggressive and start to return some of that poke.
With Doublelift and Aphromoo so far up the lane, though, they do have to be careful of the double teleport play. That's one of the things that we were hoping Europe were going to do yesterday against North America, but it was actually Rainover and Bjergsen that roamed first. So we always have to watch out for that extra summoner, the ability to get across the map and make those global plays.
Definitely do, but that's one of the advantages of keeping your opponents pushed in. They know there's never been a chance for them to get that ward behind them, and until they have moved up on the map and actually place the good ward for that TP, it can't happen. So they're trying to keep them locked in the base. They're trying to limit their options.
But as a result of that really nice level one, Doublelift gets to go back and get his perfect timing to instantly pick up that BF sword, then walk back to lane. Now he has that advantage, whereas BB will look for a different component.
But because Doublelift recalled, that ward has now been placed. Aphromoo standing right on top of it. It likely won't end up in a play unless Aphromoo goes way too far up in lane. Hang on a second.
This aggression because he knows Reyno is behind him, but here's the response of the TP. Most likely going to be not canceled. Maple, he's going in onto Aphromoo. Gives him the quick first after, but he's going to be backing away, and Reynova's jumping all over the place. But nothing will happen in the end from that play.
And both top laners now have expended their TPs. Maples is down, so you can go right back to being aggressive in the bot lane. Aphromoo's summoners are down, though. We get to see Karsa really get involved whatsoever. And that was Reignover's first ult, so he knows that he can kind of get pretty aggressive without much of a threat of a counter gank from Reignover.
And now there's a bit of a tricky situation in the bottom lane again from BB and Albus. They haven't recalled yet. They're up against BF Sword, which means as soon as they do recall, now they're going to get shoved in if Doublelift and Aphromoo are still in that bottom lane. They're going to lose a lot of damage on that tower, and it becomes difficult for them to actually recover that as they're just continually shoved in time and time again. Doublelift will re-establish the CS lead in this bottom lane.
So one of our big storylines coming into the game was looking at the junglers and how they were going to impact at least the early game. And we may get to see that as Reignover is heading up to the top lane. But Ziv is already making his way back. But Karsa and obviously Reignover haven't found their way into these lanes just yet.
Well, one of the things we just saw was the ult, the second part of the ult from Maple. He utilized the LeBlanc mimic up into the top side where it's got this massive range. You can just kind of have a LeBlanc clone appear, and it fakes out your understanding of where LeBlanc is on the map. You can see that Reignover had to kind of think twice about ganking there. And that's just one of those mind games that we're going to see from the good LeBlanc players, always utilizing it at the important times because they were picking up blue. So it actually was this, you know, situation where LeBlanc's off the map. Where actually is she? She could actually be top.
Separating the good LeBlanc players from the great. And Karsa, he's going to be taking away his red buff as well before he looks for anything else. Has that control ward as well, so maybe looking towards that Dragon Vision. The first one is, of course, Infernal, so there will be a scuffle over that one for sure. 8 minutes into this game, no kills just yet between the LMS and NA.
One of our questions has been answered, though. Is Reignover looking like he's going to go right back to the tank build here on Rengar? Jorm's Fist into Lucidity Boots. Oh, actually, that was almost stolen away, but this is the exact same build he did yesterday. Then he went into a Deadman's, and I think we may just see that once more. Reignover was always more of a tank Rengar player, even when he had played it in the past, so he's kind of going right back to that.
And it's scary how much damage you still have as a tank. You find any squishy target, and it doesn't matter that you're building resistances. Reignover's looking for Karsa, but Maple is here, thinking maybe he gets out of the bush, but
he'll be backing away. Maple's following after. Is that clone real? Will be chased down, walking the kitty cat. As he jumps back in, I'll force the flash from Maple. Bjergsen following up with the combo. Quick hit there. Aphromoo caught by himself. Karsa running him down with the tether.
But this could be first blood
as well. Maple's there to find him. And first blood as Aphromoo well caught in enemy lines.
Yeah, Aphromoo just took a stroll through the jungle. Yeah. And he's like, oh, not my side. Sorry, guys. That's going to be first blood going over to Maple, who is exactly who you did not want to give that to.
And the amount that the NALCS All-Stars had been pushing in the bottom lane, you can kind of understand the mentality of, oh, I've got the clear path through this jungle, right? It can't be warded properly. But look at the bottom side. There's control wards. There's wards all the way around. And Aphromoo was just walking up past, kind of having to flash back in after the blast plant because they realize Aphromoo's a free kill here. You know, Doublelift's in the river, spotted on a ward. So there's no way Aphromoo has any help there. Actually uses the blast plant to deny Aphromoo using it as an escape tool into the dragon pit. So, you know, it looked a little funky from Karsa, but in the end, has the desired effect.
Yeah, just cutting off another one of those escape routes. So just being corralled into that jungle there. Bit unfortunate for North America, but I'll take that one for now.
Yeah, I just think that was kind of pretty silly from Aphromoo. He knew that they were there, right? They just had a fight, a 2v2 fight in the jungle. He knows his AD is in the river. There's four guys there on the map, so a bit silly. He's going to die. It's not the end of the world, obviously, but as Bjergsen, you're now going up against that LeBlanc who does have the kill, and as the rest of the team, too, you're going to have to deal with this. And if LeBlanc gets rolling, it can be pretty terrifying. We saw what Maple could do on Katarina. It's going to be that or even worse with a fed LeBlanc.
Yeah, nice little play there from Maple as well. As Albus was clearing out that ward, he just sensed a clone down there. Just a bit of backup as he walked back into lane, so Bjergsen didn't see him. And I really just like the fact that Maple's been looking towards these new mid laners and the new changes and actually bringing it to the mid lane, and he has all this stuff prepared for us.
Yeah, I'm really enjoying the assassin play. The one question and reservation that I have in my mind is the same with a lot of picks throughout history that people say, oh, they're very strong, they snowball very heavily. Is in scrims that works exceptionally well, the same with solo queue. But if you can't snowball effectively again and again and in a passive game, because stage games and important competitive games are a slower paced quickly. Then we end up seeing these picks like Ryze that can actually start containing the LeBlanc later in the game, and that's what we need to have answered.
Oh, he stole it! Steal away from Reyno, but Albus gonna follow him after. We've got Nautilus coming in from the top side. Nape on the follow-up. Crescendo! Everyone dance! Everyone die! Oh. And they get wiped! And Impact comes into the fight. This is not one that he wanted. Poppycopter gonna get shot down from the skies. 5-0 to LMS.
4-0 in that fight. And the Dragon Steal, that insult to injury there, as LMS just absolutely cleaned up. Maple putting on a clinic here, was able to land so much damage. He hits them all with the W, puts up the passive, then he can bounce his Q and get a massive amount of DPS out there, and that is so big for the LMS, as they're going to get the first turret too.
And a beautiful crescendo from Albus. Didn't even flash in for it, just lined up three, takes him out, and allows Maple to just knock them down on the last little bit of health. So this was the steal coming through, which, you know, it sticks at around 2,000 health for a while. Reynover goes back in, but Kasa straight in for the steal.
I mean, once again, Doublelift not really with the rest of his team. As they get fully collapsed on, Nautilus comes in from behind. There is that beautiful ult, and you can see the passive going up. There's the bounce from Maple as he is able to clean up. Impact not even able to get out. Does waste his flash and his TP there as he goes down.
And that raises an interesting question. You were talking about Doublelift being on the bottom side of the map. Well, we saw him split pushing a whole lot yesterday on Twitch, and it took him a long time to start ending the game where they were looking to carry with the Twitch. If that kind of happens again, they don't have the success between Reynover and Bjergsen in this game that they did to rely on in yesterday's game against EU.
Well, and they don't even have a lead in the bot lane, right? He's actually down a couple CS, not that that's too consequential, but the kills plus that means that it is starting to be a bit of a deficit down there. First tower has already gone down, and that does give you such a large infusion of gold, specifically because you have three of those kills on the LeBlanc, that it's going to be terrifying. This guy already has his first item completed, plus his Sorks, and he can start popping people.
It's absolutely massive. He's going to give an attempt onto Bjergsen. Pops a double jump in there. Big shield coming out. Keeps him alive, of course. Ooh. Courage of the Colossus also coming in there. That was like half his health bar. It's just like, what, is this Tam Kench in the mid lane?
I mean, he hits the chain. That's two summoners gone. And because he's that strong, you have to respect it. If Bjergsen doesn't flash there, he's just dead.
Reynover following on to Kasa, but it's 2 versus 3 right now. He'd be quite big himself, comes in with the ace in the hole, but Reynover gonna jump right into the bowler, and he's gonna hit the dust. Bjergsen and Afremu trying to find the portal out of it. Albus, what a god! The double ultimate once again, securing the kills for LMS.
Oh man, Albus, his ultimates have been so, so good. Double lift.
Kasa maybe picked up, it's not quite enough. Double lift committing, Maple with that shutdown. 9-0, putting on that clinic.
Yeah, these guys are just outclassing the North American LCS in this game. LMS is looking on point. 5 kills now for the LeBlanc. If he wasn't already scary, he's going to be a terror. And once again, what are they even doing taking this fight? Your mid laner is back. He already just blew both his summoners. They're taking a 2v3 here where their AD carry is not in position. And this is just not putting a lot of thought into the fight.
Yeah, if Reynover, maybe if he's going full damage, is thinking I can get one of them and come straight back out of the fight. But you've got the tank. Oh, Albus, what a beautiful ult for a second time. We were kind of looking at the Sona pick and talking about where its strengths and weaknesses were going to be.
Well, we found
that's what Sona always is going to do if she can land that, the flash into the crescendo. And then double lift, pushed up in lane, no help around him. At that point, he was trying to get out already, but they were closing the gap way too quickly.
Yeah, it looked like Double may be able to reclaim one kill as the flying Kasa went through one of his traps, but it wasn't quite enough damage. And after all of that, not even a single kill on the board. This could get to the point where NA gets perfect gamed. We're on track for it.
I think we're 0-9. We're entering Worlds status here. But we gotta get one on the board.
I don't want to feel like a defender. We are a little early, perhaps, for perfect game discussion.
Yeah. I don't know. We're a little way up. 5-0-4, Maple LeBlanc in the mid lane.
We're only at one tower. Like, I appreciate that the possibility
you need to get something from this.
That's very true.
Yeah, I mean, we are pretty early in the game. It's certainly far from over, but it is a very big lead and a heavy advantage going the way of the LMSs. They certainly have the ball in their court. These guys are looking really, really good, and it's going to be up to the North American team to actually kind of make some plays here and try to get something going.
And you know where I feel like it's going to end up coming from? after Impact gets a second item. He has been a playmaker just time and time again, and I want to see him actually have some sense of presence in this game, because right now, Ziv and Impact have almost done nothing, and double it just dodges away.
Ulti from Rain over.
Never wants to come in. He's falling onto Albus. No, he wants out. He wants out because of the people coming in. Curtain Call will be lining up the shot, but Maple shut down. Goodbye, perfect game. And Rainover, he doesn't need that bowler. Bjergsen following on to Karsa, looking for BB as well. And now he wants to get away.
The TP's coming in.
Coming in with the Qs, he's shut down by BB. Rainover, nice flash out of the way, but he's followed up to Ziv. No running away from the Northless. Double kill for BB. Now Impact looking to be the hero that NA needs. Courage of the Colossus keeping him alive. Ziv, he's kind of caught in no man's land right now, and BB trying to save him, but he's just so damn tanky. Double lift can't cut through that Nautilus. He's going to be slammed against the wall by Impact. Another shield. Albus and BB, the flash over the wall. Double lift trying to get out. Nice verdict. We'll keep them alive, but Impact tugged in by Ziv, and BB happy to sweep up the mess here.
Good Karsa time.
Coming from the side. The return kill. Shut down. Impact is going up, but it may not be enough. Somehow he's still alive. Ziv. We'll be having to run away now. There's no Iceborn, so he's not going to get slowed at least, but that was a very sloppy play.
And they need to be aware that LeBlanc is back on the map, and Maple is making his way over here. If Poppy does get caught out, he will go down, but should be okay for now. But I have to say, Impact got a lot of work done when he TP'd, but where was that TP earlier? That was ridiculously late. Not one, but two members from the LMS completed their teleport before he even started thinking about it.
Exactly, and when we look at the replay, we can see why the initial TP was late. But then the question is, why not after Ziv shows up? Because look at the top side, they're actually close enough against each other that they would be able to block the first TP and then the second, so they don't want to use it yet. Rainover tries to go in. Here comes Maple, getting instantly, you know, crowd controlled and taken out. That's one of the weaknesses, is if you come directly into the fight alone, you will get picked up. Now Ziv has dropped back in TPs. Impact should be TPing immediately into this fight. Only now was a ward placed though, so he has to TP to the tower. It's the fact that there's nothing to come to. The minions weren't there. There was no ward. So from there, he gets work done, but it's just a little too late.
It certainly was very late, and Ziv honestly had left lane like 10 to 15 seconds even before he TP'd, so Impact could have made something happen. They do on the later end of this get some work done. It was very well played by Doublelift and Impact in that kind of two versus the world, and it has been some kills finally going over to them, so they are shutting a little bit of the snowballing down.
Yeah, but at the end of the day, it's still almost a 6,000 gold advantage. I'm rounding up from 5.4k. It's around 5,000 gold.
We'll give you this one.
You LMS. That's
fine. Oh, he's caught him again.
Caught out. The long range damage, and it doesn't matter that you have that shield. BB is going to find you.
Again, Albus finds them, takes out Bjergsen. Now they're onto the mid tower. This is going horribly wrong for North America. Bjergsen's not even able to try and make plays aggressively with this ult, but here goes Rainover. What are you
going? Good. Punish by himself. He's got double lifts and Afrumer to help him out. Afrumer, he's turned into a different animal, but the Riptide has gone back to the void. 13-2, 20 minutes into the game. And LMS with those two dragons as well. At least Maple going to be picking up this blue buff, actually going to be stealing this one away. It's definitely not their side of the jungle, but I guess it is now.
Yeah, and I mean, they've taken both dragons. They're taking away the buffs. They're pushing up vision, taking down the inner tier two there. This is textbook. This is really good League of Legends, and they're honestly looking like a very coordinated team. It doesn't look like a fun, you know, go lucky, have fun.
That's the all-star.
Hey, LMS, they're taking very, very seriously, and the next step of this that they've started to do already is remove the NALCS vision, because that is when LeBlanc is at her most deadly. She just sits around a corner and waiting for you in a bush, and instantly you get popped. You get taken out, and suddenly you start losing towers, objectives, further map control. So there are still areas. You can see the LMS have decent vision control on the bottom side, but there's a couple of wards still spattered around there that if they can get rid of, they can start really punishing Bjergsen for walking through the jungle like they just did.
All right, I guess at this point in the game, we need to start looking at those shining lights for NA now. We've got that one kill to double lift. He's sitting on the Hurricane going into the Infinity Edge. Hasn't got that second item yet, but going to interrupt that point as Impact is charging up. The copter does not land onto Karsa. He was blinded. Maple going to come around the corner. Rainover's there to try and get the assist down.
Jump onto
Karsa, but got the long-range support from BB. Ooh. Doesn't quite land onto the Poppy. Good body block there from Rainover. Do we have more support coming in from NA? Yes, we do. But so is Albus.
And this is super risky for them to try to defend. It's a 4v2 right now. Afro is coming up, but even then, the turret's going to go down and with Impact chunked out, and I cannot stay around.
I'm going to say that's not a good recall location for Impact there, so he's going to wander back to his tower.
And the other thing here is this is too far for Bjergsen with his ultimate. This is the other side of the map completely, whereas Zim has the teleport. If he drops back in the pocket behind the turret again, he can look to TP play.
Going down too.
Bjergsen has to recoil if he wants to get here, but then just choosing to fight. So as you said, this turret is going down because Impact previously was so low, he actually just had to TP back to the top lane just to defend against that push.
And that feel when the top lane Nautilus is dueling your middle laner, your Bjergsen, team solo mid laner, 0-4-1 currently. And you just cannot get through that shield. He's just too tanky.
Yeah, I mean, Bjergsen is 0-4. He's not ahead of this guy, right? He's behind. And Ziv has the early Spirit Visage. He has the Merc Treads. And he has Scourge of the Colossus. Yeah. So it's going to be really tough to actually punch through the Nautilus at all until a much later stage for Bjergsen. He's going to need a Void Staff. He's going to need some more completed items. But that's a long ways off. And really, NA is kind of putting their eggs in the Bjergsen basket. They're saying, go to the side lane. Get some levels. Get the farm. We trust you to carry later in team fights.
The same can be said for Double Lift's items as well. When you look at this, he's only just got the Infinity Edge as he recalled then. So he is still a long ways off being able to shred through the Nautilus, through the Graves, because Nautilus is likely to get more armor now as his next item. So there's a lot of tricky spots that NA just have to try and not fight if they can.
Yeah, I mean, itemization becomes very difficult when there are these kind of super tanks like the Nautilus that you have to deal with, plus an assassin who kind of says, you need to build a Hex Drinker, you need to build some MR, or I'm going to one-shot you. And it's kind of, which do you go for? And oftentimes, the premier AD carries will say, you know what, I'm going to position perfectly, I don't need the MR, I'm going to go for the damage.
So looping this one back to Champion Selects, we were looking at LMS and saying, hey, look, they have a very much a pick-based composition, and I think they've executed on that very well, considering how the game's gone so far. They've leveraged that into those objectives, but where's their breakpoint for NA? Where did they get strong to the point where they can start challenging LMS in those 5v5s?
I really think it is completing 3-4 items, these kind of points for Caitlyn when, you know, she has rapid fire on top of this, you can really start putting out a ton of damage. And Bjergsen completing his Seraphs and getting an Abyssal of Void, they need to complete more items, and that means they need to delay. So yeah, it's going to be up to LMS to force fights around objectives, look to make NA fight you now around the bear and around dragons where they don't have vision, and close out the game that way.
The problem is the NA All-Stars have picked fights earlier on in the game, and the point that it leads us to is the fact that Maple has done twice as much damage as any member of the NA LCS All-Stars in this game so far. That's what you get when you fight a LeBlanc this early in the game, and after a couple of kills, a couple of items, suddenly you're wondering, why is this LeBlanc doing so well? It's because your Reignovers decided to fight time and time again.
And look at the flank they're setting up here. They're looking for a fight here.
Oh no, Aphromu, the depth charge is locked on him. He's not going to allow that to hit any more of his teammates, but the TP is now coming in from Maple, so he'll join the fight. Reignovers leading the charge, but he's now being revealed. And the rest of ICE are grouped together, so I don't think Fire really want this fight, considering the state they're in for.
Now, if Maple can't... Ooh, Kasa!
Well, nice pick onto Kasa. That'll start off the fight.
Impact so well done there. The flash stun. Rogue charge against the wall, pins Karsa, they take him out, and that is a big play from the top laner.
And that's the difficulty for this composition that ICE are running, though, is if they go in head first.
But this is going to be Ignatius at 4v5. This could look very good for the NA lineup. Reignover, he's kind of dancing back and forth. Redemption came down as well.
I would like to point out that everyone was hitting Ziv in that fight. we did about 2% HP. Good job, guys.
And he's regen all of that back up with Albus there behind him as well. That will secure Team Fire the Dragon. Reignover's going to jump into the bush, give himself the push there. But Impact for the crescendo onto four players. Ziv's going to be chased down by Reignover, jumping back in one after another. Ziv, he's taken the brunt of the damage from Team Fire. He'll tank that after, but Bjergsen wants in. He's going to teleport four people into the back line. That will find BB, and now Ziv in enemy territory. He's going to be run down, and it's just a matter of Impact slamming him against the wall and getting Reignover in there for the kill.
Impact is making this stun look like it's just a point and click ability. Like, there's no setup involved in this thing. He seems to be able to get people on command. And Bjergsen, though,
but didn't get a chance to get away. But Reignover, he will avenge his mid laner. Maple, he's going to have to jump away with that distortion. Albus there to back him up.
I swear there used to be a rise on my screen. I don't know where he went. Someone's going to have to fill me in.
we have to CSI the crime scene. There was a LeBlanc running away.
Well, Elvis.
Points and click ability indeed. Impact. I don't know how we did it.
That was fantastic CC chain. Rain over lands the empowered Bola. Double it, follows it up with a trap, and then Impact slams him into the wall. Beautifully done.
This was a messy sequence that eventually goes heavily in favor of the NALCS All-Stars. Let's take a look at how it started, because the key difference here is the fact that Maple cannot find a way into this team fight. He cannot get onto a squishy target. This is the second phase that, despite a great crescendo, again, look at it, the damage dealers are not able to stand and fight. Maple cannot get in. Bebe can't find the space because of how low he is, and ends up with four members right around him as Bjergsen ends up taking him out. Before this, Maple was in a situation where he was looking to go head in, and if he goes just in through the front door, he's going to get room prison, just like he did in the bottom side, and get taken out. So he's been a lot more careful with his engages now that he's died once.
And let's be honest, they had no jungler. It was a 4v5 the whole time, right? If Karsa is there in that fight, we saw how Rainover was exceptionally low. We saw how Impact got very low. They're just dead. So it was a lot of that on the back of the pick that Impact created, and he has been a big-time player for North America to kind of get them back into the game.
And that pick all stemmed from the NALCS All-Stars basically playing the LMS's bluff, knowing that they can't engage head-on. They forced them out of the mid lane, around the corner, and they were saying, we'll get a turret or anybody that tries to come for us. So it was a good call for NALCS to just go straight down mid, knowing LMS couldn't quite get the positioning on the team fight that they needed.
I mean, a real heads-up play, you know, getting that pick onto the pick team themselves. Karsa, one clearing out the Baron wards.
Almost. It is twice as clear.
Twice as clear. The double control wards going down. It's always scary clearing out the Baron ward as Graves. Not sure if one of those pellets is going to anger the Baron. Don't want to be taking too much damage. But Impact now in the bottom lane. I don't think there's too much to say about this fight, other than that they are hitting each other. Well, not really doing any damage.
They're both going to get a shield up at exactly the moment that the other's shield is up. So it's just going to always continually be trading, but it's like
fighting.
It's kind of losing out.
Yeah, I mean, Ziv is kind of winning.
But get him, Ziv.
I don't think it's going to be enough to actually kill him.
What a hook.
So it just becomes about the pressure that he gets in lane. So he wins that skirmish. Now he gets lane advantage. He can get the push going. Impact has to base. So that is what he got himself there. I don't think he was under any illusions. Like, oh, I'm going to get him, guys. I'm going to get him. You're not going to get him, but you might get the minion wave.
He wants him.
Impact just wants to ult it away by the looks of it.
Don't always get what we want, boss.
No, we do. We do not indeed. But I'm happy to beat LMS Pulse for this game, though.
Yeah. I mean, I wanted TSM to win Worlds, so how did that go for me?
Oh, boy. Hello. He's in this 1v1. Oh, the damage jump for Maple, but there's Courage of the Colossus. There's the shield on his shield, but it's not enough to keep him alive. Karsa with the assist.
Well, we learned the answer to the question, can Bjergsen take that fight with three items? Still no. despite still having some MR and a fair amount of tanky stats, so...
I think he needs more items than you can get to win a 1v2, but still.
He's got the inverted scoreline there for Maple, so... Rest in peace. He'll get there. He just needs those four items, Azale. That's all he needs.
That's true.
That 50-minute mark, the palace fight. That's what we're looking for.
We're scaling.
We're scaling, boys. We've got the late game. Yeah. The classic solo queue. Keep the morale up. Don't worry. We can make this work. 16-7, though. 30 minutes into this game with a 7,000 gold lead to the LMS. But Baron is not yet down. However, speaking of Baron, LMS is looking for it.
And this is really what they need to get to crack this game open, because the gold lead has stagnated.
Whoa, double lift!
Bad.
Deleted by Maple.
And goes right over.
Going to jump in. He does have the shield. Nice cleanse out of the ultimate there from Albus. Going to be knocked up by the death charge, but Maple, he's causing havoc in the back lines. Bebe taking out Aphromoo. Jumping over the wall. He's going to be secured by Karsa. Rainover looking for the hero play, but not today. You are not the protagonist of this story.
Look at Maple's damage when he finds somebody on their own. Doublelift doesn't know what's hitting him, and just suddenly LeBlanc takes him out, and it opens up the easy, clean Baron play for the LMS. And this, at this point, should be enough to close this game and start getting the inhibitors down. This is the kind of lead that they really have been looking to open up.
Yeah, I mean, three members dead. There's no contesting this one. And the question is, does LMS just march it down and try to actually close it out, but I don't think they will. They're going to base, they're going to spend their gold up, and this is definitely the safest, smart play from them because they have the pressure in the mid lane now. They can look to the side lanes and try to really play it safe.
So let's take a look, because we didn't catch this actually the first time. Doublelift on a ward. easy combo for Maple to take out. And that was the start of this fight that eventually leads to Baron. Reignover a little fortunate because he gets that combi disabled through the crescendo, but still ends up, you know, losing out on this fight for the NALC.
This was pretty slick, though, by Reignover. Not only to stay alive, but to get around, he jumps in onto Bebe, attempts the steal. Had he got it, that would have been pretty sick, but not going to work out for him, and not much has been working out for NA in this game. Down 10k, and going to lose another Infernal.
Even at that point, it's worth just trying to go for it.
It totally is, yeah.
Try and be the hero. Try and turn your fortune around. We've seen it happen time and time again, but at the end of that fight, both Maple and Bebe were almost set on 3,000 gold each. So that's why they needed to go back. They needed to go and make sure they had just enough to be able to close this game out, because they have just been on fire this entire game.
So I just heard that Maple has done 25k damage, and NA have done a total of 50k damage. He's done 50% of the entire NA team's
damage. Us here in North America, we're about teamwork, so you gotta add
it
all together.
Let's bring it across. All right.
It's camaraderie, you know.
You, Azale.
We're doing fine, guys.
I mean, you're not, but 19-7, and Baron buffed LMS, who are pushing into the bottom lane, but I appreciate the optimism.
Hey, good hustle, right?
Good hustle.
They're doing their best, and they are trying to defend this bot lane turret, and it's just about stalling at this point. Stall, stall, stall. LMS want to close it out with this monumental gold lead, with the Baron buff, with everything that they have in their favor right now, because the reality is, yes, they're crushing North America right now, but if you give it another 10 minutes, if you let these guys continue to pick up items, the gold lead starts to matter less and less and less, but it's going to be a huge task to stay alive.
As the towers are just falling left, right, and center, you can see Maple going on Bjergsen on the top side of the map as well, and pushing up to the turret. So, I mean, there's just so much in the pressure game here for the LMS, shoving constantly in with the mid lane, having super minions streaming in. I don't think we're going to get to that 10-minute point without a horribly botched fight by the LMS. If they try one of the ones where they're looking to go in through the front door, where they tried in the mid lane, then perhaps NALCS have an opportunity to hang on.
The Baron buff has almost expired, though, so once that goes down, it's going to be a big boon to the North American team. We'll see if they can make it to that point.
They are just trying to weather the storm now. Delaying tactics from NA, double lift with the wonky wall of traps. I always love the nice, clean line of traps. I always get triggered by the wonky wall, but
it's enough, though, because they're all short-range champions, pretty much, on the LMS squad, so they can't actually step close enough to really deal damage. And as you said, now that the Baron buff is close to expiring, suddenly, this wonky wall is fairly effective.
They're looking for the dive.
He's just going to crash right through it. Here comes the engage under the tower of Akasa. He's in a little deep. That's a nice exhaust onto Maple, keeping them alive. And Impact going to stay alive as well. Maple coming in there, looking for the assassinate. No one's down just yet.
Everyone's still alive here for NA, and they actually do hold on. A lot of summoners blown there by the LMS team. Their carries are without their flash, so NA holds on.
Yeah, they hold on because beautiful ultimate from Impact to knock so much of the front line out. And Maple, his eyes were on going in. He wanted to be in that fight, in on the back line, but he was the only one. He was surrounded, so couldn't get the majority of his damage down. Look at where Bjergsen positions himself, flashes up onto the top side, away from Maple so that he doesn't get taken out. Impact hits out the Nautilus and the Sona and Caster. Look, Maple tries to go in. Low health targets, but he cannot capitalize because he was solo in the middle of everybody else. Cannot pick anybody off.
And part of that is the change for LeBlanc. You have to actually stay in long enough to proc your passive to really kind of pop people. Old LeBlanc, you just go in, you QR, someone's dead there. You cannot do that with LeBlanc. You need to stay in long enough for your chain to proc or to get the second spell off. He couldn't do it this time, not able to complete one of those kills.
What an ultimate from Impact. That Keeper's Verdict literally knocking three players away. I don't even think I've seen a triple Poppy ultimate before in that scenario.
Impact has really had the team on his back this game.
Oh, yeah.
He is doing so well. He does not want to lose.
This game, this tournament, I mean, Impact yesterday as well was going deep. But Impact is really
turning into this
tournament.
1v1 was pretty
hyped too. It was, yeah, absolutely. So if Impact can make it work, I mean, he's looking at his team right now, 1-4, 1-6, 0-6, and he's just like, look, guys, don't worry, I've got this.
When, you know, watching the NALCS over the last year, it's kind of what we've come to expect, though, right? It's Impact. He's showing up consistently when they needed to. And this is exactly what the LCS All-Stars need, is this defensive play off the Impact Ultimates, denies the fights and stops the snowball. We're at 1 minute 15 until Baron. We know LMS are going to have to go for it to be able to push in for the win. If this time Doublelift doesn't step over a ward and get assassinated, they should be in a lot better spot.
Yeah, and honestly, we talked about items earlier, right? A lot of these items are now coming in. Doublelift has some lifesteal and his magic resist from the Mercurial. We see the Void Staff completed for Bjergsen. The Armor Pen's coming in for a Doublelift. These are the key items that they need to start getting to become relevant in these fights. And Maple, he's huge, but he's capped out. He doesn't get stronger from this point, whereas Bjergsen still has room to grow, still has another item slot to complete.
You know, Azale, you're the type of person I want on my team in solo queue. Forever the optimist. Guys, they've hit their power spikes. We've got this. We still have time to scale.
Guys, we're level 11. They're 18, but they can't get higher. Don't worry.
We can only get stronger.
We can't lose by more.
Rainover, just don't face Shaka Brush. Okay, it's fine. He shimmied on out.
Now, I want to see once Aframu actually has the Locket completed, just that actual, the increase in effective health that the NALCS team are going to have. Because with all of the shields, with all of the resistances they have, if they get that boost of a shield on top of it already, Maple, again, is going to struggle to catch anyone out. And that's where Bjergsen kind of takes over in the mid lane game. Oh, Rainover. Gotta be careful that he doesn't get caught out by Albus and the rest of the LMS.
And this gets really dicey because Maple's already in the base. He's pushing the inhibitor. This is gonna be dead no matter what. But what does NA do? Because the LMS are gonna push on multiple sides.
But for a moment there, you don't know whether it's the real LeBlanc. Oh. You have to second guess yourself. So Maple's gonna try and get himself out. They couldn't commit instantly.
Oh, he's the TP.
TP's out.
At least he got he had the TP there for the NA team, but that was really smart from Maple. I love that he's able to do that, and with how much AP he has, he actually punched through that and hit super quick. So now the pressure is back in that lane. Top Wave will always be pushing. The Baron is on the field. The Elder Dragon is on the field, and LMS has 3 dragons to 1. So they have all the pressure here, and it's going to have to be Impact sitting up in that lane trying to clear these waves out. And they're going to start up the Baron. They want to get his TP right now.
Well, you are 5-man strong. Maple, he's sitting in the wings looking for a pick.
Just give it up.
Rainover, he's going to try and find a steal. He'll jump in. He's going towards the Baron. Can he find it? No. It's secured by Carter. Impact of Rainover trying to scurry up this fight. Double Lip being chased down. And Ziv will find him with the assistance from Carter. Rainover getting blasted down. That's the double kill. Impact. Bjergsen, it's now damage control for the NA lineup, but it's not gonna happen. LMS are chasing them down. They're scattering the roaches. And Impact trying desperately to run for Maple, but that's the shutdown. The five for zero. 24-7. The Baron over to LMS.
A clean fight for the LMS. This time they caught Doublelift in the fight. There was no damage to be done. And despite Bjergsen hanging on, he was on his own. Even Impact was low health and backing away. What a performance from the LMS All-Stars.
Yeah, Doublelift gets caught in that fight. He gets taken out, and Maple, Karsa, Ziv kind of combining to take down that AD carry means that is that. LMS is going to take down North America.
An unbelievable win from LMS, a surgical removal of NA from the game.
I really like what the LMS All-Stars are bringing to the table. Karsa and Maple working very effectively together. And we talked about how we were expecting the NALCS to do the same kind of thing. But this time, you look at the synergy between Rainover and Bjergsen didn't quite seem to be there. This time, it was Ryze instead of Orianna. So the combos weren't available as early on. And they didn't really get the ball rolling on that until it was way too late.
Honestly, to me, this just looked like a team playing a group of good individual players, right? LMS played like a team. They were always on the same page, whereas the North American players are all fantastic, but they were not playing well together this game. We saw, you know, Rainover and Bjergsen going into a 2v3. We saw Aframu getting caught out for first blood, kind of walking by himself, and the team never seemed to be on the same page. Doublelift was rarely with them when they were looking for these team fights early, and it just felt like LMS was too organized, too well prepared, and got too far ahead.
And that's disappointing because yesterday we said the NALCS, that was one of the major strengths they had against Europe, was Europe looked unprepared, NA looked like a team, and today you can't quite say the same.
And you know, we came in saying, look at the junglers, look at the mid laners, but it was the entire team, and it was the entire team of LMS actually getting together. Impact looking crushed there, not able to take the win here. He tried his best, but I think you hit the nail on the head there, Zale. Like, they just played a textbook game.
Yeah, they really did. And, you know, an Impact and Rainover looked like they weren't really sure what happened. They were still trying to hash it out at the end. They were talking about it. Obviously, pretty distraught about the loss, trying to figure out what went wrong there. And I think there was a lot of things to pick up on. But it was a very exciting game. We got to see LeBlanc played to the highest level. And Maple has not disappointed. Even losing against LCK, this guy looked incredible on Katarina. He's looked incredible on LeBlanc. And I can't highlight him enough. He has just been a monster in this tournament.
And I think one of the best things about that is we talk so much about how good Maple is, how good Kasa is. Albus showed up this game, huge in the team fights. The crescendos, multi-man were instrumental every single team fight.
Yeah, I think there was just so much going on. I felt like we overlooked him just a little, but I don't think he even died that game. He was just hitting once.
One death,
and 19 assists. He was hitting crescendos left and right, a massive part of their win. And honestly, just got to praise the LMS. And it's like, they came here to have fun, but like, what's fun? Oh yeah, winning. Winning is fun. And that's what they just did in this game. Absolutely amazing. Just congratulations to the LMS squad.
Yep, not much more to say than that, but I think we are going to get more from that victory. We're going to head it down to the stage where Dash is standing by with a killer LeBlanc from the Flash Wolves.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. That's right. I'm standing here with Maple and Christina, who's going to be helping us with some translations here. But I got to talk to you, Maple, about the fact that we've seen a very high level of competition already in this tournament. So just speak to me a little bit about, you know, the individuals that have been invited or rather voted into this tournament and how good they are.
首先恭喜你获得这一场比赛的胜利。那虽然明星赛是比较趣味性的，但是比赛非常的激烈。那你觉得有哪些选手表现得非常优异吗？
表现非常优异，说对面还是我们？都可以，或者你也可以。我觉得比尔森的雷兹三等那波吓到我了，像他点了那个坦克天赋的巨人勇气，其实让我吓到，所以我三等就被打散，我觉得他那波玩的蛮好的。
I was very afraid of Bjergsen when he was level 3 because of his mass, how his masteries were set up. So I was pretty afraid of him at level 3.
Yeah, that was a very unique mastery. Have you seen Courage of the Colossus taken on Ryze in the mid lane yourself, or have you considered doing that?
你自己有想要点过这个天赋吗?
我从来没有看过，所以这是我第一次看到。
I've never tried or seen it before, so this is my first time.
All right, well, you dealt with it very well. A very impressive scoreline on LeBlanc, but we also saw you get to play Katarina yesterday. So you yourself, of all the mid laners, have gotten to play some of the most feared mid lane champions. What is your thoughts on both Katarina and LeBlanc as they've been reworked?
大家都知道你是玩比较多刺客的英雄。那昨天也看到你玩了卡特琳娜。那你对卡特琳娜跟勒布朗这两个角色有什么想法吗？
我觉得勒布朗的话是当前版本基本上算是最强的角色。那卡特琳娜的话，我觉得 在没有打线特别强的时候呢，他的滚雪球能力蛮强，就是他当有优势的时候，他可以很快的滚起雪球，然后对手很难阻止他的杀轮。So
LeBlanc is probably the strongest in this meta. As for Katarina, when she is not in laning phase, she can snowball pretty easily and also, you know, become really, really strong in late game.
And finally, you yourself are known very much as an assassin player. I want to look towards the 1v1s. Both of our finalists from last year have been eliminated. You get to play later today in your first round against Bengi. How confident are you in your ability to run the table and be the next 1v1 champion?
接下来等一下晚一点会有一打一的比赛。那去年达到决赛的两位选手都已经被淘汰了。那你觉得你接下来对上 Bengi 几开？
对上 Bengi 的话。 其实我蛮有自信的，因为我们在钻研那个单挑，其实打了非常多场。
I feel pretty confident going against Bengi because we practice a lot backstage.
All right, well, there you have it. We look forward to that matchup. Once again, congratulations on the victory here, Maple. And of course, thank you for the translations, Christine. Now back to the desk to talk about that match.
Thank you so much, Dash. Before we get into the nitty-gritty game stuff, he out-purpled you guys hard.
He did. He looks like Hugh Hefner, honestly, and that is pretty impressive. I think we look pretty
That's
good.
That's a unique shout-out for a Riot
honestly,
Games broadcast.
Right there.
Yeah, all right, let's talk about the game. We talked to Maple, and picking up, again, an assassin, it was left open, and we were all kind of scratching our heads of like, okay, how much is going to do? And you guys had a lot to say about LeBlanc in the current state without us seeing how she went off in that game. How strong do you think it is, and how should that matchup work?
LeBlanc is definitely very, very strong.
Right at the top of the power.
S-tier assassin. I mean, Maple said it himself, just because it is so hard to play against like LeBlanc overall. Her damage is great right now. The new ulti that you can even twin like stealth super quickly can make it hard to like assassinate her as well.
And the flexibility also right now. She has the wave clip. She has so many things, but they traded. It wasn't just giving up a LeBlanc. They traded it for the Poppy, and they had the Ryze also available as a pick they really wanted.
And yeah. You guys did say that you thought that scaling-wise, the Ryze should do better later before all the mayhem happens.
Well, I like Ryze against LeBanc right now. One, yes, you can outscale into the late game, but actually more importantly is the early game. Obviously, Curse of the Colossus for Bjergsen is something I know a lot of European players have been doing as well, because I've at least seen it before. I'm a little bit surprised Mabel hadn't seen it. So basically because LeBlanc has a 0.25 second delay on how she can distortion back to her original position. So when she jumps in, Ryze will just put like a Rune Prisoner in her face, get the big shield, and just like trade once with her Q in her face, and then she has to jump back and she kind of loses that trade automatically. So I really like this matchup for Ryze.
And we saw the level 3 especially, when he went in for a trade, LeBlanc probably felt very confident, and then suddenly it was the Q shield and the Courage proc, about 300 shielding just earlier than you could expect, and it looked really good for Ryze early. But then LMS turned it on. The TP play this game was insane.
Yeah, definitely. LMS, they came to a crescendo in their first team fight. Let's take a look. Brought to you by Acer, because that Sona had a lot to do with it, by Albus.
I mean, the TP, though, is the real win here. The fact that they could put out such a clean TP, Nautilus was on the minimap. TP's right behind. This is, of course, the HQ duo. Ziv in the top lane, Albus put down the ward earlier. And the Wombo engage here. The level of clean plays on the TPs especially, this is better than SKT were able to pull off, our world champion.
Whoa.
Now Duke's
wow.
Duke's not good at the TP, so that's the one thing where unfortunately SKT fall down. But this was really impressive.
Yeah. I just want to make sure, because he was doing a replay. People didn't think I said it as the Western caster. I'm like, oh yeah, SKT.
Yeah, your
got
voices
that great.
Are totally similar.
It was the LK caster who said
I'm
it.
I'm basically Danish.
There you go. You are more or less Danish. I agree 100%. No, we saw these fights. We saw more of them as well. LMS were on fire.
Yeah, they were, and we are taking a look at the stat line from Albus. So talk to me about your thoughts about Sona in the current meta. We know that. She is squishy, and we saw that NA tried to target her early, but Albus had a fantastic showing once you get out of that laning.
I mean, you talked about early. I mean, they blew the flash at level 1, and I'm like, Sona laning without flash is going to be terrible, but they didn't actually use that window of time when they could really take advantage, and Sona got through the laning phase, and that should never be an assumption. That's the thing, is that Sona is great out of laning phase, but can be punished and wasn't punished.
I mean, one of the problems with Rengar specifically is pre-level 6, you're not really ganking, so yeah, okay, there's no flash on Sona, you know, you can't really abuse it too hard. I like Sona with the items there is now, especially Redemption. Obviously, we like it on every single support almost, but the fact that you can go Redemption, then Mikhail's, because Mikhail's buffs your shields and your heals, and obviously the change that happened to Sona like some patches ago, where her W now shields as well and everything. So Mikhail's like benefits both the item and Sona specifically in the late game, gives her enough cooldown reduction. It's actually really strong later on, and especially if you play like Albus did in this game, because he landed so many good ulties.
Yeah, NA did find another window to come back in the game, but it wasn't enough. We're going to take a look at a couple of more fights to close this out and see the items that Sona had in the Redemption in play as well.
We thought this was the comeback.
We thought.
It technically was a comeback for now. First, they struggled to deal enough damage on this insanely fat Nautilus just sitting there with double shielding as well.
But the thing you should take away from a fight, that's the reason why we really liked the Fireteam going forward, is that the front line for Caitlyn was immense. Ryze, Rengar, of course, tank Rengar once again from Reignover, and the Poppy. Theoretically, it should have been Caitlyn just free-hitting. If the game was more even, this front line would have been super sturdy, but it wasn't because of the snowball we saw from the great TP players and the LeBlanc play, specifically from Maple.
Yeah, again, it wasn't just one TP player early on. It was like multiple ones of one in the bot lane as well, where LMS picked up some kills. And I just want to see this LMS lineup be a thing after All-Star. Like, I want it to be a team, because these are like the five best players you can put together in the LMS now that obviously we have
Albus and Sword Art was kind of the big
Sure, now Albus is kind of taking that spot here, and BB has kind of overtaken Ahn as well. So I want to see that lineup be a thing next year. Obviously, we probably won't get to see it, sadly, but they're showing how good they actually are, like these five-star players together. And NA obviously have five very good players as well, but LMS came out on top.
Fantastic. And they also netted 100 points for Team Ice. LMS jumping in and saving Europe in a game, at least.
For now. Revenge.
Yeah. And what do we think of the NA squad? Are they going to be too taken aback by this loss? It's a tough one, but it's also one of those where, like, yeah, the block got rolling and then we just got rolled over. So what do you do?
I think they'll shake it off. Obviously, they have one more match left. Korea, of course, have to pick up the slack, unfortunately, of NA once again. So, I mean, as long as Korea win their three games, I can feel good about myself.
This would actually be a very good day for Team Ice, because Europe, taking on GPL next, Europe will be favorites to win that game. And if China can beat Korea at the end of the day,
possibility.
That's a ton of points for Team Ice right there.
You got your ice jacket on too, so.
Exactly, representing.
Sending out the good vibes. We're going to take a quick break. Next up, the Howling Abyss with a twist. It's been a while since we've seen the Poro King, and he has some new tricks up his sleeve. Don't go anywhere. You won't want to miss it.
Okay.
Like it's better.
It's way better than Janna. And
yeah.
Better than Janna. Better. I mean, who's that idea, man?
Yay!
Oh, it's gonna follow him after. We've got Nautilus coming in from the top side. Maple to follow. Crescendo! Everyone dance! Everyone die! The Oxen and Afremu trying to find the portal out of it. What a god! But Bjergsen wants in. He's gonna teleport four people into the back line. That will find BB. And now Ziv in enemy territory. He's gonna be run down. But Maple, he's causing havoc in the back lines. Baby taking out Afremu. Jumping over the wall. Whoa. He's gonna be secured by Carter. Reignover looking for the hero play, but not today. Impact of Reignover trying to scurry up this fight. Double it being chased down. And Ziv will find him with the assistance from Carter. Reignover getting blasted down.
That means that is that. LMS is gonna take down North America.